That's this paradox that I have to replace and just show up for
session. Well, he has done more than enough.
Yeah, but I can't share my talk.
Why not? You know, he would be speaking English.
Can I have more
time? Am I like that Venezuelan president who talked for hours and hours and hours and hours? What was it like?
Chavez. So let's expect that everybody understood what 5 minutes means. So let's
add
other 5 minutes let's welcome another speaker, which is Yogesh Joglekar from Indiana University. We will speak about the title is slightly modified PP lattice model.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity to come here and visit, and I should thank Joshua for all the hard work he's put in organizing this wonderful conference. I'm going to tell you about, I'm going to tell you about simple models, which I like to call PT lattice models. These are systems which are finite lattices, and when I'm considering these systems, really what I'm keeping in mind is some sort of a waveguide or resonator realizations of it, where things are coupled to each other in an evanescent coupling, and then you can introduce loss or gain. And unlike a lot of work which has been done on lattice models, I'll stick to even simpler realizations where most of the sites, if you wish, or sort of nodes of the lattice, the places which correspond to an individual waveguide, are neutral. In other words, they are neither lossy nor gain. Sure. All right. Is this better? All right. Thank you. Okay. So I'm going to tell you about these models, and I am at, as Awad has been saying, it's a palindromic university, a joint campus of Indiana and Purdue, which has a small presence in Indianapolis, and this is a work done in, we started with actually Awad when I was visiting Los Alamos lab. I have had some few things I'll talk about are done at University of Pune during my sabbatical, and then this last line I'll explain at the end of my talk, although I seem to have a number of young kids who work with me as well. So, you know, all of you are familiar with PT, or many of you are, but a common theme that I have seen seems to be this type. When you hear about PT talks, then this is what you see. You have experimentalists, and what they have in their slides are nice samples, their micrographs, and maybe STM images, and things like that, and then actual data about what happens, and so on, right? Okay. And these are all pictures taken from recent papers which have come out on active or gain and loss systems. And then when theorists talk about it, and I should thank, I think Carl is the pioneer even in the presentation style, and I'm going to stick to it, is this sort of stuff which shows up in the PT theory talks, right? You know, you have that, you have parrots, you have Mr. Bean. This is just to avoid copyright issues. This is some sort of a modified version of Godzilla versus Mothra. And so this is me. Yes, where the work is done all in the head, or at least one would like to claim when you're not working. And this is the tools or the lab that we use. Okay. So I'm a theorist, and here is the outline of my talk. Okay. So the outline is, you know, it doesn't really need belaboring, but I'll just point it out anyway, which is that I like to think about PT systems as systems which have balanced gain and loss. Okay, right. So the P and the T operators, I'll talk about a little bit later, but essentially these are systems which have some notion of balanced gain and loss, and they undergo a transition from a case where there is a quasi-equilibrium situation or quasi-static situation to a situation where you are far away from equilibrium, which is what is the PT phase transition. Okay. And then I'll tell you a few models in which such an analysis leads to what I think are interesting predictions, basically. And so I'll focus on first just tell you about what are sort of what is the model that I consider, which is a finite lattice. And I'll show that in that you get non-trivial boundary effects, basically. Okay. If you just consider a tight binding lattice with just one pair of impurities or one pair of gain and loss systems. Then I'll consider the same lattice maybe and with some time periodic gain and loss, basically. Then I'll switch gears and consider space periodic lattices and what kind of results we get. There may be some debate about whether to call these models really topological insulators because it's one dimensional case, but I think it's an abuse of notation which has been used in the literature significantly. Then if I get time, I'll talk about some other results regarding diamond models, where in the PT broken phase, there is a possibility of sort of experimentally observing a topological transition as well as its softening that happens because nonlinear effects are important. Okay, right. And so I'm not sure if I'll get through all of it, but that's all right. We'll just see how far I get. Okay. All right. So. What's the system? And as I mentioned, it's a very simple lattice, although there are a few points that I would like to sort of emphasize. So that's my lattice model as 1 through n sites. And you can think about them as waveguides or resonator rings or things like that, which are evanescently coupled to each other. And this coupling could be arbitrary in the sense of T1, T2, T3, some different values. And that's one of the things which I think is quite interesting regarding waveguide realizations of lattices as opposed to the natural lattices which occur in condensed matter systems, basically. So more specifically, the tunneling is tunable. Basically, you can choose it to be within reason, whatever you want, and it can be variable from one link to another. So we have tunable tunneling. We have tunable on-site potentials, which in the waveguide realization is just index of refraction on the site. And so you can change that from site to site as well. You can introduce disorder in it, and that disorder can be comparable to basically the tunneling region of the sort of, you know, a regime of disorder which is not accessible in, let's say, condensed matter systems. Okay. And also experimentally, typically you couple light to one of these sites, or your initial state of the particle starts out on one site. And what that means is that you have the entire bandwidth which is accessible, as opposed to condensed matter systems where you're living in one part of the band, at the bottom of the band near the half-filled area or the top of the band, but not the entire band. Okay. The other interesting part is, of course, that gain and loss are possible or implementable in these systems. Okay. And I'll be considering, for the most part, open boundary conditions. So the first waveguide is not coupled to anything on that side, and the last waveguide, obviously, is not coupled to anything to its right. All right, so in this sort of a language, what is PT symmetry on this lattice? And in this case, I consider P to be what I consider sort of intuitive parity, basically. Not an arbitrary operator, which is P squared equals 1, but rather a intuitive notion of parity. Okay. So in that case, what you would need for PT symmetry is that the tunneling be symmetric as you count from the ends. So in other words, T1, Tn minus k should be T star k. This tunneling has to be equal to that one. T2 has to be equal to Tn minus 1 if they are all real numbers. Okay?
Yeah.
Right.
You really mean Tn minus 1, not Tn. You've got too big an n.
All right. So this should be n and this should be n plus 1.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. So this tunneling between 1 and 2 has to be equal to the tunneling between the last edges. That would be what will be the notion of PT symmetry on a lattice if T is real. And similarly, balance gain and loss is just saying that the potential at, let's say, site 2 is a complex conjugate of the potential at site 2 counted from the other side, basically, right? Okay. And so pictorially, you can look at a lattice with some configuration of gain and loss, and just prima facie, just look at it and say whether it will have a finite threshold or not, basically, because you can look at it and say whether it has a PT symmetric structure or not. So just to, you know, go through this stuff again, well, you have this system, has six sites, let's say, and the equal lengths indicate equal tunnelings. And of course, this system is PT symmetric, and as you can imagine, it would have a finite threshold. Okay, trivial. The system, the second one, is not PT symmetric because it's uniform constant hopping, fine, but the gain and loss are located in a position which is not symmetric, basically. Okay. And this is of importance when it comes to finite lattices. In an infinite lattice, whether that or this is the same, basically, because you can choose your origin for parity transformation arbitrarily. But in a finite lattice, it will matter, basically. And so this system will have a zero threshold for PT breaking. The third example is a dimer lattice, if you wish, or part of it anyway, where I have site 1 and site 2. They have some stronger tunneling between them compared to site 2 and site 3, and that pattern repeats. Okay, right. So if I consider this lattice, or five-site system, if you wish, basically, then you do see that the locations of the gain and the loss are parity symmetric, but tunneling is not. And so you would think that even this system basically will have zero PT breaking threshold, right? Okay. And just to sort of point out that it's not completely trivial. In fact, it turns out this one does not. Okay. So some exciting stuff. You can read stuff off of pictures, but you know there's more to it than that, right? No, because the tunneling is determined by the spacing between the waveguides. So the tunneling between two waveguides is determined by the distance between the two waveguides, basically.
No, they are separated equally in the second example.
Now, this tunneling is independent of this tunneling.
Example.
Yeah.
Second
example.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, second example, the tunnelings are all the same, but these ones are not located in a PT manner, so it has zero threshold. Okay. Right. All right, so these are sort of the models that I'm going to consider, okay? And just to remind you what happens in such systems, this is from the first paper on PT symmetry, which had an active medium, basically, right? And so, roughly speaking, PT systems are balance gain and loss because parity is exchange of gain loss locations, time reversal is exchanging gain into loss, fine. And so the three sort of canonical behaviors that you get for what happens to the state of an initially normalized wave packet or a certain number of photons that you put in into the system is the following. In the PT symmetric phase, when you have real eigenvalues, then you get intensity or total norm of the wave function as a function of time. Well, basically, these oscillate with bounded amplification. Okay. So the norm is not preserved, it will oscillate, and of course I'm using the normal Dirac product to do all the calculations in this case, okay, right? So it has bounded oscillations with some amplification. At the PT boundary, or the exceptional point, the intensity grows is a power law, depending on the degree of the exceptional point that occurs, and it turns out in finite lattices with appropriately tuned parameters, you can basically generate systems where you get exceptional point of whatever order you want. Okay, so there are lattice models where you can do that, essentially. If you want an exceptional point where order 4, well, there is a foresight model which will do that. And then in the PT broken phase, you get exponential growth of the intensity, which is, of course, cut off once the intensity increases, because then this model is not a good description. The gain parameter cannot be constant. It will basically die out, as has been alluded to in multiple previous talks. Okay, right. All right, so this is a general generic behavior. And so now I'm just going to start from this baseline and go in different directions and see what kind of results we get. Okay. So the first thing that I'm going to do is just to take these two just system with one gain, one loss, and add more neutral sites. So in other words, you know, make the lattice bigger, okay, and see what happens, basically. Right? I have just gained one gain, one loss, and what happens if I implement it not with two waveguides, but with 10 waveguides, still having one gain and one loss, for example, or 20. Okay, and you can carry that out. All right, so this is the cartoon of my lattice, where it's a uniform spacing lattice. So it's a lattice which has constant hopping amplitude and basically has one gain and one loss, or has one active and one passive system. Although I should point out that this equally applies to a system which has just losses. If those two losses are different at these two sites, then above a certain background, this system gets mapped onto a PT symmetric system. Okay, so. All right, so what's plotted here is the threshold, PT threshold, measured in the units of the constant hopping as a function of distance between the gain and the loss. Okay, how far are these? So naively, one would think, well, they are closest, the threshold is high, because the communication between them is high, basically, and that's the metric of what determines the threshold. Right? And now, as you start to increase the distance between these gain and loss impurities, the threshold will go down because they're not talking to each other as much, basically. Right? And that would be sort of the result in an infinite lattice. Okay, and that is what you find initially, starting from a value of 1, that is the result for a two-side problem, if you wish. You get that the threshold decreases. Okay, but it only decreases until the system starts to feel the lattice edges. Okay? And so, as you start moving these locations where you have these active and sort of gainy and lossy channels, the threshold actually picks up. And if you have a array of waveguides, for example, where the first waveguide has gain, the last waveguide has loss, and in between just neutral waveguides, then even in that case, and this is one of these cases which we can solve analytically as well, actually, you get that the threshold is the same as if they were equal to each other, as if they were closest to each other. Okay. So this is what you would expect in a finite sort of infinite lattice with no boundary effects. But the boundary effects are quite substantial, is what would be the conclusion from this. And so
above the lines are broken PT and below the lines are unbroken.
That's absolutely right. Below this are the values of gamma, where the PT symmetry is unbroken. Above it is broken. And these are for two different system sizes. You find that as the system size increases, for intermediate separations, the threshold decreases. But at these two points, you can analytically show that it will continue to remain equal to the tunneling, basically. Okay.
Is that bump in the middle some sort of resonant effect?
Right. So this bump is there. I think that it goes away in large system size. So it's a finite size effect.
Internal scattering.
Isn't it pinned by the two ends?
Pardon me?
Isn't it pinned by the two ends?
Meaning?
You know, it has to be one in the infinite limit, and it has to be one at the boundary.
Why does it have to be one?
Well, that's what you found.
Yes.
That means it has to dip in the, unless it goes straight across, it would have to dip.
No, his question is, why does it rise up in here?
Oh, that one. Oh,
yeah. So that part does go away in the large system size limit.
Oh,
okay.
Right.
Yeah.
The edges.
Right.
Yes, it's getting smaller when you go to any resonant.
Yeah. All right, so you find that essentially this is, one simple example. Even if you have two active sites, or one active, one gain site, one loss site, if you add a bunch of more neutral sites in between, because of the boundary effects, essentially, you do see that the PT threshold initially decreases with the distance between the gain and the loss, but then it recovers and actually comes back to the same value it had. And this case is for an even lattice. If I have an odd lattice, then the nearest that the PT symmetric impurities had come is basically a distance 2 away. You know, think about a 3-site lattice. Right, because in an odd site lattice, the center point has to be neutral. And in that case, you find that the threshold is given by this when the distance between the gain and the loss is smallest, and actually not only recovers, but it essentially approaches a value which is twice the value that it has when they are the nearest if you move farther away. Okay. And these are results basically come out of numerics or an analytical calculation. You can do it both ways. They match each other. So it's pretty solid. Questions?
In the emission case, is there any boundary effect at all?
Depends on what you mean by boundary effect now, right? So, because here, we...
It just falls.
No, in the Hermitian case, the question is what problem are you solving?
Yes.
Because in this case, we are calculating when do the eigenvalues become imaginary. That's never a question in the Hermitian case. So now you have to redefine a problem. Okay, what is meant by... What's the problem you want to solve for which... Yeah.
Would it be the case that the boundary plays no role? That curve just falls and stays falling forever?
The question is, what is that curve, right?
The response but, function.
Yeah. So, yeah. All right. So, this one is sort of one example which comes out in finite lattices where the number of PT impurities, if you wish, is much smaller than the number of lattice sites. Okay. Right. All right. So, this is one. Sort of finding which comes out of a simple analysis, and it's really showing that if I consider a PT lattice or a lattice which has put in these impurities, then the edge effects do matter. And that's because at the edges there is reflections and that does lead to enhancement essentially of what should be the threshold. Just because you take two impurities, the gain and the loss, and move them out, that does not mean that the communication or effective communication between them decreases, basically. And that's what one would expect in an infinite lattice case. All right, so now I'm going to actually come back to a simpler problem, which is a problem with, instead of having so many lattice sites, just two sites. That's the canonical PT model that has been theoretically and experimentally investigated. Okay, and make some changes to it and see what happens. So now what I'm going to consider are sort of results for a system which is just two waveguides, okay? But those are waveguides which have time periodic gain and loss. So the system that I have, you could think about it as a dimer. The red one is gain, the blue one is loss. But then in the time direction, and that's my cartoon of sort of two waveguides with the time direction, whatever was the gain channel slowly becomes neutral and then becomes a lossy channel. Whereas whatever was the loss channel slowly becomes neutral and becomes a gain channel in this particular form. Now, one would imagine implementing this is experimentally difficult, and I imagine it is, but remember that this applies equally well to just, you know, a system where it's sort of switching between two losses. So maybe at the beginning of the waveguide, you have one waveguide has this much loss, the other one has even more loss, and by the end of it, they have switched positions, okay? That would be, again, the same problem because static PT and purely lossy systems just map onto each other, basically beyond the background. Okay. All right. So let me remind you what happens in a system. In a Hermitian case, if you put in a time-dependent potential, and that's a problem we do in, you know, initial quantum mechanics, and the time-dependent problem is not completely trivial, basically. And you can sort of think about the effects of that potential in three parameter range or three frequency ranges. The static problem, if I introduce a perturbation to a problem, then the effect is proportional to the perturbation strength. Now, if I make that perturbation time dependent, then at high frequencies, you have vanishingly small effect because it averages out. Then at exactly the resonance, that is to say the perturbation frequency being equal to the frequency of the unperturbed system or the gap of the unperturbed system, you get a very large effect for arbitrarily small perturbation. This is basically population inversion or Rabi flopping, whatever you want to call it, right? Okay. And then at very low frequencies, essentially what we call is adiabatic transport, maybe along with some geometric, non-trivial geometric phase, which might be acquired in such a system, depending on the topology of whatever parameter space in which this sort of wandering is happening. And what I want to do is to consider what happens to this when I consider instead a time-dependent gain and loss, so in other words, a non-Hermitian Rabi problem. Okay. All right, so on formal level, I have this Hamiltonian, is periodic, it has these eigenvalues. This spectrum is going to be purely real at all times if gamma naught, the strength of the perturbation, sort of gain and loss is smaller than the coupling. But of course, just because these instantaneous eigenvalues are real does not tell you anything about the Floquet exponents or what would happen to an initially normalized wave packet. Okay. So the formal method is, of course, that you need to calculate the Floquet Hamiltonian and find out what is the exponents for that. And that is not a problem which is well understood if the operator is not Hermitian, basically. Okay. Right. So we do this analysis, and the question is, in this case, how do we define what is PT breaking? So one way to define PT breaking is, of course, consider the Floquet Hamiltonian, look at its spectrum, and find out when it changes from being real to purely, complex conjugate pairs. The other operational way is where we take a time, initially normalized wave packet, time evolve it, and look at the time dependence of the intensity that you get. Okay. If you consider you are in a PT symmetric phase, then basically the time evolution would still lead to bounded intensity oscillations. On the other hand, if you are in the sort of PT broken phase, then time evolution is going to lead to some exponential intensity behavior, basically. So those are sort of two methods by which we can analyze this problem. And so the question is really, what is the PT breaking threshold for this two-side problem where you have modulation in frequency? Okay, right. Hey, come on in. You want to talk? All right, so if omega is 0, then this is a static problem, and the, of course, the threshold is gamma equals j. We know that very well. So this is what happens if you consider the problem in the frequency space. Okay. So what is it? This is the PT phase diagram. This is the gain loss strength, the strength of the modulation, gamma over j. And this is the modulation frequency with 0 being up here because of vagaries of MATLAB and me not taking efforts to correct them. All right, so at omega equals 0, you have one, wherever there is deep blue region, that's PT symmetric phase. Wherever you see any other color, that is PT broken phase, okay? So what are the main features of this result, basically? And this is the system, once again, to remind you. At omega equals 0, that's my old problem. It's been studied theoretically, experimentally. Everybody knows what happens. There is a single transition at 1 here. So that's why it's blue here and red over there. Okay. Now, what are the main features of this diagram? One is that at high frequencies, there's no PT symmetry breaking, or PT symmetric phase is recovered. Because you see that no matter how high value of gamma, if you kick up the frequency high enough, there is blue region here. And that's not very surprising. I mean, if your frequency of the oscillation is very high, then over the time frame over which the particle goes back and forth between the two waveguides, or the characteristic sort of frequency scale of the problem, you basically see average gain and loss, which is 0. And so you get recovered PT symmetric phase here. Next, I want to sort of focus on this region, which is, maybe a frequency which is equal to the gap of the system, but the strength of the PT potential is very small. It can be arbitrarily small. Okay. And what you find is there is tiny region in here, and it's sort of, cone-shaped, where PT is broken at arbitrarily small values of the PT symmetric strength, basically. Okay. So the gamma value can be arbitrarily small, and you get PT symmetry breaking if your frequency is matched to the frequency of the system. Now, this one also is sort of intuitive. Essentially, what's happening is the particle is going back and forth between these two wells or two waveguides. And then if its riding matches the riding of the gain and loss that's happening, then all it will see is gain no matter how it rides, basically. Right? So by the time the particle maybe starts out from the gain medium here, okay, and it goes over to the loss medium, or so-called loss medium, basically, but by the time it has reached here, this has become a gain medium. Okay. So as long as that frequency match takes place, no matter how small the strength of the gain, how small the gamma, you are going to get PT breaking. And so you can analyze this problem analytically as well in this sort of neighborhood with some perturbation theory. You can find out that it's really linear behavior with some slope that you can calculate. And so what it says is that if I have a modulation of gain and loss, then when the modulation frequency is right enough, then PT symmetry breaks at arbitrarily small strengths of the threshold, or arbitrarily small strengths of the gain and loss. Okay? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So paraxial approximation, you need translational invariance in the z direction over length scales, which are not related to the coupling length scale. Right.
So we just have to think of this as a model problem.
Yeah.
Not a paraxial approximation.
No, this is paraxial. It is paraxial approximation. I mean, it can be implemented in waveguides with paraxial approximation as well. So the question is Z invariance over what scale when you are doing?
Z invariance and paraxial approximation, they are not related questions.
Yeah.
We can have the electric constant, for instance, dependent on Z, and you still
backscattering.
Yes.
It does not give you backscattering.
If the potential depends on Z.
That's true. But so if I am
So it's, okay. The other point, you bring up another point which maybe I wasn't going to talk about, but, you know, the other point is, okay, one of the things that, you know, modulating waveguides does is introduce some effective loss, okay, basically, right? So one of the things that we could do is think about this as a system which is not necessarily active and passive, or active, gainy, and lossy, but rather maybe two loss values and interpolating between them. But, all right. So you get sort of, you know, here you have PT restoration at high frequencies. Here you have what I'd like to call PT Rabi effect, if you wish. And then the third part is this neighborhood of static threshold at very low frequencies. Okay. What you see here are multiple windows where there is PT broken phase, PT symmetric phase, broken symmetric. And so we try to investigate that a little bit closer to see what's going on there. Okay. And so, this is sort of a close-up of a system, not just two-side system, but you can have a version of it with, you know, many sides. So this one is for a three-side lattice and an eight-side lattice, for which, once again, we are exploring what is happening in the neighborhood of the PT threshold. So that's one. That is where the static PT threshold is, okay, right? And you see essentially similar behavior. Once again, blue color means PT symmetric phase, and any other color means PT broken phase. Yeah. And this one is at fairly low frequencies. It's going from, you know, half of the characteristic scale of the system to 1/20th, basically. And what you find is that if you keep on going, you find a sort of tower of PT transitions that happens at lower and lower frequencies if you are at static threshold, basically. Okay? And the question is why, basically. And sort of, you know, the intuitive answer is that if you are not at static threshold, there is a characteristic frequency scale for the problem that's given by square root of j squared minus gamma squared. So that is a frequency scale which is becoming smaller and smaller. The gap of the eigenvalues is becoming smaller as you approach that. So to reach adiabatic approximation, you need to have frequencies which are much smaller than that. But exactly at threshold, you don't have that, basically, because the eigenvalues are degenerate. That's an exceptional point. And so essentially, what you find is that at arbitrarily small frequencies, you do get PT broken and PT symmetric phases as you keep on reducing the frequency of the perturbation, basically. Okay. And once again, this picture just shows that going from 0.5 of the frequency all the way up to, you know, 0.01, let's say. Okay. And this is just meant to show that you have recurrent PT symmetric, PT broken, PT symmetric, PT broken regions appearing at arbitrarily small frequencies.
So this is sort of like opening and closing of cigars, you know, those eigenvalues. So you have all real eigenvalues, and then you have a few, and then more and more complex ones, and then fewer and fewer, and so on. So it's like the cigars are opening and closing in the pictures, for example, that Chenghai was showing.
Oh, probably. I need to talk about that.
That's
sort of, you know.
What you're saying, right? That as the color changes in the broken region, it means that you have more.
Indeed, within the broken region, that is true. Right. That is correct, basically.
That's
no.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's
no.
Exactly
what no. Yeah. I think the thing that is, within the broken region, how many eigenvalues are broken will indeed be sort of related to the color of this.
Right.
And I think one of the things which I find very interesting is that in this case, at arbitrarily low frequencies, you do get some effect, basically, which is something that is absent in normal cases because you always have a gap. Whereas in this case, in the exceptional point, basically you end up finding that you have a ladder of transitions. If you are sitting somewhere outside of this, then at low enough frequencies, you will get a behavior which is just PT symmetric or PT broken, but it will be a behavior which will be continuous with omega, basically. Okay. All right. So this is sort of the findings that come out of an analysis. If you just consider the simplest problem, but now introduce time variation, basically, or time dependence of the gain and loss, basically. Okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Aren't you going to have instabilities also?
Well, if you're driving it with gamma of t, then that's basically your rabbi problem. That's optical pumping, right? Basically, it's the problem that you do in quantum mechanics. And in that case, you get non-trivial effect only in here, because there is no such sort of characteristic frequency along this axis. Okay.
You see this, in the lighter, in the cone.
He means in the center.
In the center of the
Oh, these ones.
Yeah.
Those ones are just color gradations figured out by MATLAB when it's plotting data. So, there is no physical meaning to them. The color does indeed indicate how many PT broken states are there or how many eigenvalues are becoming complex for the Floquet Hamiltonian, but, that's just MATLAB choosing color to discretize. Yeah. All right. Any other questions? Okay, so what this tells me, actually, sort of the richness of this phase diagram tells me that periodic stuff, even with the simplest problem of two-side PT, if you now put in time-dependent gain and loss, or just time-dependent loss, which is switching between two values, then it gives you a rich phase diagram for breaking, which is otherwise absent. Instead of a single transition, you get many, many transitions, including transitions at arbitrarily small strength of gain and loss parameter, basically. Okay. All right, so now I'm going to switch gears and tell you about another model where instead of time dependence, I'll consider space dependence. Okay. So what is the model? The model is basically a model which has space-periodic tunneling. Okay. And this is something that you can build with waveguide arrays, for example. So the tunneling has a particular formula. This set of models go by the name of Andre Aubrey Harper model or Sushri for Higer model, and these are fairly well known in condensed matter, at least in the infinite lattice limit, basically. Okay. But really, the basic idea, for those of you who know, this is the formula, but those of you who are not familiar with, let's just stick with these two examples because they illustrate the point. No, this one is just, it's basically models which, I don't want to go. Yeah. All right, so what do we have? We have a model where you have, once again, let's say five waveguides, but this tunneling is stronger than this tunneling, okay? And you can think about it as if there's a dimer sitting here, which is weakly coupled to another dimer. Which is weakly coupled to another dimer, or maybe part of it. Okay, it will turn out that this part of it piece is actually important for what I'm going to say. Okay, and period 3 would be a structure like this, where there is some tunneling T1 or T2, which is smaller than or stronger than T1, and then a tunneling T3, which is weaker than the both of them. So this three waveguide would form a unit cell, if you wish. And then there are many of these unit cells repeated that would form a model which has a tunneling profile of this form with beta equals 3, period 3, or beta equals 1/3, period 3. Okay. So these things have been studied very well. And what I'm telling you is well-known stuff in the community. It's not something that we discovered. If I look at a tunneling model like this, it has, when lambda equals 0, it's a constant tunneling model. So it allows for reality check. And when lambda is not equal to 0, it gives modulation of tunneling between adjacent sites or between adjacent waveguides, basically. Okay. And what you find is, if you calculate the energy spectrum, you find a spectrum of this type, okay, where the vertical axis are energy eigenvalues, the horizontal, well, divided by J, and the horizontal axis is this parameter phi, which I call flux, because this model also maps onto electrons in a magnetic field on a square lattice, in which case this term is somehow related to the flux. Okay? But the main point is this is periodic in beta, or k going from k to k plus 1 over beta, and it's also periodic in phi, as you would expect. Okay? Right. And the main things that I want to take away from this well-known, well-understood results is that the band structure is, or the energy levels are of this type. And by that, I mean this one is energy levels for period 3, so a structure like that. And what are the main issues, what are the main features, is that there are three bands then, okay, basically. So if it's period 3, there are going to be three bands. Each of band has states which are extended, and then whatever are the remaining states sort of go between the bands, and those states are localized. When they are between the bands, if they are touching one of these bands, then they become extended at that time. Okay, right. So that's the general structure of this sort of a system, and they go by name of topological insulators, although that's sort of debatable because it's a one-dimensional system. Okay, right. All right. So in general, you have total of p bands. If the periodicity of this lattice is p, then or the unit cell size is p, then basically you have p bands with p minus 1 mid-gap states, so you know these states in between. And this picture just shows what is sort of the behavior of the eigenstates. So the sort of the blue curve is one of these states in the band, and that's extended from one end of the lattice to the other. Okay? Whereas one of these red states, the states between the bands, those ones are localized at one end or the other of the lattice, or between two ends, depending on, you know, exact geometry. Okay, right. All right. So these are sort of one-dimensional models which exhibit localized edge states. Okay, and that's really the main feature. Right. Okay. And then the question is, does this system have a threshold, or you know, does this system have finite threshold if I make a PT version of this? Okay. Our interest in this really started because, I think maybe 3 or 4 years ago, there were sort of two or three papers published in Physical Review B, which talked about how PT topological insulators are not possible. Okay, right? No. Yeah. So okay, fine. So no. What do you mean Dirac point? None of these bands are crossing. So. Well, the topological insulator means that if you have a Fermi energy somewhere here, then the state at Fermi energy would be localized and therefore would not contribute to transport, basically. It would be only localized at the edge. Now, the point is that in this case, the edge is not point, not traversing, and so there is a question of what is meant by transport, which is why I, you know, put my initial disclaimers. Yeah. Correct. You know. 10 minutes. How many? 10 minutes. Okay, that should be. All right. So the question is, does this system have a threshold, and what sort of models we can build off of this? Okay. Now, there's one sort of property of these edge modes that I would like to point out, and that is that these edge modes have nodes at certain locations. Okay. Right. And that's a general property of edge modes which are between the bands, as opposed to at the bottom of the band or the top of the band. But that property will become important when we are looking for PT symmetric versions of this. Okay, all right. Okay, so here's a system, and now I'm just going to change it and put in one gain and one loss in this system. Okay. Right. So here's my lattice. This one is sort of period two or a dimer model. Okay. And the one on the top has six sites, and it's, you know, visually PT symmetric, so obviously it has a finite threshold. Okay, that's sort of obvious. If you start out with this system, do the analysis, yes, you get a finite threshold, but that's not very surprising. Here's the second system I'll consider. It's just this lattice, but you know, instead of having integer number of unit cells, I am having integer number of unit cells plus part of it. Okay, right. And this one is not PT symmetric by the look of it. Yes, basically, no. It does have one gain, one loss at locations which are symmetric. However, the neighborhood of this and the neighborhood of that, the tunneling, is not, basically, all right? And so in that sense, the eigenfunctions, the non-interacting eigenfunctions of this model, or you know, the eigenfunctions of the Hermitian part are not symmetric. So perturbation theory will sort of imply that actually this model should have zero threshold, because when you calculate corrections to the energy perturbatively, those corrections actually depend upon difference of the wave functions at PT symmetric sites. Okay? So when you have PT symmetric potential, that difference vanishes and you get real spectrum. On the other hand, if you have asymmetrical wave functions, which they are, as I've showed here, then you would expect naively that the threshold is zero. Okay? Well, almost right, but not quite. So if you calculate the threshold, and what this shows is this color scale is for the threshold in units of J, and this one is this parameter phi, and this one is the location of the gain potential, location of the red dot. So if the red dot is here, that corresponds to m equals 1. If the red dot is here, it's 2, and so on. And this one is done for beta equals 1/3. That is to say this lattice, OK? All right, so if I do that, then this is what I find. If I put in my gain impurity at the end, I get threshold 0. If I put in here, the threshold is 0. If I put in at site 3, the threshold is finite for all values of phases, phi, okay? Put in here, 0, 0, at 6, again finite, okay? Right. Also, this one only happens when the number of sites in here is not an integer number of unit cells. In fact, it needs to be an integer number of unit cells, so 1, 2, 3, and the fourth unit cell, whatever is the last unit cell, must have one unit less. Now, there is a way to sort of understand it in terms of how many localized states you are getting and so on, but really, otherwise, this phase diagram would be just a blue square, a blue rectangle. It would be all zero for all other values of n. And this is why this is not a feature which will come out of any sort of infinite lattice model, because in that case, we naturally start to think in terms of unit cells and then doing Fourier transforms and whatnot. Okay? And such a system will, of course, give you that the threshold must be zero. However, it's not. For this cases, it is non-zero, okay? This one is for beta equals 1/3, or, you know, 3 period. You can do it for sort of beta equals 1/2. This is essentially Su-Schrieffer-Heger model, if you wish, or dimer lattice, but not with integer number of dimers, basically. It's integer number of dimers plus a fraction. And depending on the strength of the modulation, you get some phase diagram. But the bottom line is you do get non-zero threshold for these models with appropriately designed number of sites and with appropriate locations for a single pair of gain and loss impurities. Okay? Fine. Now, it turns out the reason this is happening is because there's some hidden symmetry that these wave functions do have. Okay? Even though the wave functions are not symmetric, at every, you know, third site, they are symmetric, or every 1 over beta site, they are symmetric, basically. And so we can sort of understand it, it's why it's happening. Okay. So what you have here is a model where you get edge states with nodes at these sites. The P's are basically the period that I'm considering. And these do not contribute to PT breaking. So above the threshold, if I go above the threshold, I have a value of gamma, which is higher than this. Then the states which have come together and broken the PT symmetry are not these edge states. These edge states do not couple to this potential, basically. And in that sense, they continue to have real energies. They are robust in this sense. Basically, they do not contribute to PT breaking. Okay. How much time do I have, Ms. Lau? 3 minutes. Okay. All right. So what I'm going to do is not tell you about this. If you have questions, I can tell you about it. Okay. And instead.
If you want to use the time for discussion, because it was the rule,
All right, if you guys can decide on a number, then I can decide what to do with my talk.
Give him 10 extra more.
Wow, he started.
Okay, here we are in the Middle East, we can buy.
All right. So,
okay, using dictatorship powers. Speak as long as you
wish. All right. Well,
because there are already discussion questions. So that's
all right. Okay, so thank you. Then I'm going to, you know, I have one more piece remaining. Okay. Right. So what I have shown until now is that simple lattice models actually have interesting properties. Even the just now simple waveguides with one gain and one loss, or two different gains, two different losses, which are easier to implement, have very interesting properties if you sort of modulate the other parameters, if you modulate their time dependence or sort of the hopping behavior. Okay. Now, the last part of my talk, I'm going to tell you about a work which was motivated by a really beautiful paper by Rudner and Levitov in 2009, where they showed that there is a topological transition in a purely decaying model, basically, right? Or a model which is a dimer model, where on every other side, there's some decay rate. That's the model that they considered. And so we are considering essentially a PT version of it, okay, basically. So what you have is a dimer model. So now I have gone over to sort of, you know, the dark side, have infinite number of lattice and, you know, many, many impurities. So gain, loss, gain, loss. And it's a dimer model in the sense there's some tunneling between these two called nu prime. And then there is some inter-dimer tunneling called nu. And I will define this, characterize it by this ratio R, where this R going to 1 really corresponds to these dimers, which are uncoupled. And then R going to 0 corresponds to this cell, this side being closely related to that one. So it's almost like shifting these dimers by 1, basically. Okay? Right. And so this system we are considering a gain-loss system. So there's gain here and a loss here, and a number of them. And what Rudner and Levitov showed was that at least the purely lossy system undergoes a topological transition, which is in some sense easy to understand if you don't ask too hard questions. The question they asked was, if I put in light here, a site which is neutral, then where does it decay? Or what's the average displacement of its decay? You know? Now, this is purely, if it's a purely lossy system, you put in light, and of course, it's going to decay over some time. Okay. And the question is, where does it decay? What's the average displacement for that decay? Okay. And what they showed was that actually that quantity is quantized. So if this is very, very strong, we can imagine that the light goes from here, it hops to decay site over here or decay site over there. If this is strong, then of course it decays here. Okay. Right. So that's sort of the decay being zero limit, or displacement being zero limit, and that happens when R is 1. On the other hand, if this tunneling is much stronger, going between this and that, then the average decay site is minus 1, because you are going to hop from this site. You can either decay on this site or that site. But if this tunneling is stronger, then you decay not in your own cell, but in the cell nearby. Okay? And that is sort of a, they showed that it's topological transition, because this model is basically, this model or the corresponding PT model is essentially just a 2x2 Hamiltonian in the Fourier space. Okay. And then it turns out that this average displacement is somehow related to the winding number of this combination of tunnelings, basically. Okay. All right, fine. So this is something that was well known, well understood. And so the questions that we wanted to ask was, what happens in a PT system? Okay. Whether we can define a similar transition in those. And more importantly, what are the nonlinearity effects? Because once you have a truly PT system, then in the PT broken phase, intensities do increase with time. And so in that sense, we do need to take into account effects of nonlinearity to what happens to the average displacement, whether it continues to be quantized or not. Okay. Right? So there are some calculations you need to do, analytical and numerical, and we did it. And then this is the results that you get. So this is my second last slide, and then it's just conclusions. Okay. All right. So what do I start with? I start with an initial state which is weighted in the on sort of, you know, this gain and loss, some alpha weight here and beta weight here. Basically, it's a normalized wave packet. Okay, and then I just let it evolve and see what happens to calculate the average displacement. And what you find is that when r is 1, the average displacement is 0. And then when r switches at half, the average displacement becomes quantized at some different values, depending on whether your wave packet is fully localized on the gain site or it is localized on some linear combination of the gain and the loss sites. However, if you look at these numbers, you find that actually this is the ratio which is quantized, basically. So in other words, the average displacement divided by the weight on the gain site is the quantity which is quantized. If you are putting in initial state which is not just localized, but it's localized on both gain and loss sites. Now I should point out that here alpha and beta are real. For those of you who know this very well, alpha and beta are real. If there's some relative phase between them, then this transition gets destroyed, basically. Okay? So there is some requirement for this topological transition that the initial wave packet not have any sideways momentum, basically. It not have some sideways velocity. Okay? Just to show, if you calculate higher moments of the distribution, in other words, average displacement squared or cubed, those are not quantized. They do depend upon the decay rate or gain loss rate and so on, whereas here none of them do. For example, in here there are two curves which are on top of each other, are for very different values of gamma. Doesn't matter, basically. The result is the same. Okay. And that's why I think the original paper was really beautiful. I mean, you know, it's such a simple looking system and has this very nice topological transition. If you go to a PT version of it, it does have it again, although if you generalize it, it's this quantity which is quantized. And then what I show here is the effect of nonlinearity as an example of a case where we can have a topological transition and then we can see how it gets smeared out when you put in interaction effects, essentially. Okay? Right. All right, so what is shown here is, again, the ratio, and this one is the value of gamma. Okay? So when the R value is near 1, this yellow color means the average displacement is 0, and there's no change in the color along the gamma direction because this transition does not depend upon the decay rate as long as it is non-zero, okay? Or gain loss rate as long as it is non-zero. So that's why you find that this is yellow here, it's blue here, that corresponds to displacement 1, and then there's some transition region which becomes smaller and smaller as the system size becomes larger because truly the topological transition takes place only in the infinite lattice limit, basically, okay? And now this is what happens when you put in some nonlinearity. Okay. When you put in some nonlinearity, you see that, of course, the transition gets destroyed. First of all, the average displacement receives some gamma-dependent values. Okay. Right. And of course, it also receives some values which are dependent on the lattice parameters or the ratio r, as opposed to it just being exactly at a half. Okay.
What's the nature of the nonlinearity?
So nonlinearity is basically, in the Hamiltonian, you're just going to put in some eta psi squared term in the time evolution. So nonlinearity quadratic because of chi 3. Yeah.
It's a quadratic term instead of
it is the, well, it's the cubic term in the, it will be like a cubic nonlinear Schrodinger equation, or in the action is the fourth order term.
Got it.
Yeah.
Pardon
me? No, it does not suppress the exponential divergence, but nonlinearity is Hermitian, so it doesn't really affect the norm anyway, you know, in general, because it's a Hermitian term. So it might shape the packet, but it's not going to change the total intensity of it anyway. Yeah, so it is the normal, it's not the nonlinearity of the gain or loss. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. All right, so this is an explicit example where you can do calculations and show that it's a, first of all, PT systems do undergo topological transition. Well, that one is sort of expected, actually, because it's really the old work by Levitov and Reubner. But that here's an example where there are non-trivial effects which are would be absent in that model, because in the PT broken region, in a truly PT symmetric system, in a system which has true gain and loss, we are going to get basically non-linearity effects. Okay? All right, so this is the sort of the last part. And so, conclusions I won't go through, although I will mention that I have had a large number of really young co-workers in some of these works. We have a nice high school student research program. and MATLABs are amazing when it comes to finite dimensional lattices. And so I have to thank all of these for creating a lot of work over time, basically. Actually, these three are working this summer. I keep on getting questions from them. They're not happy I'm not here. But it's a topic, I think, just because it's non-Hermitian Hamiltonian, it's a topic which is very nice for even young students to approach. So with that, I'll stop.
You did two each of them, one lattice site. You did one lattice site per student.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, yeah.
In your first part of talk, when you show zoom in, so these many letters, yeah. Actually, if you go back to the Hamiltonian, this 2x2 system, there are three parameters in the system, J, gamma 0, and omega. You
right.
Always scale one out.
Yes, we have. That's why we have only two. J.
But if you scale omega out, keep the period always constant to compare the Hermitian part and non-Hermitian part relative size, and the one you show the infinite ladder, of course, appear, but it's no longer clumped together. It's nicely spread out.
Right. So the reason we did not sort of, you know, scale out omega was to be able to understand in some sense or explore the adiabatic limit, which corresponds to really omega being much smaller than the relevant scale of the system, basically, where the problem goes over to the static problem then.
Yes, the boundary for doing my way is building out omega, then you can solve the problem without any Fourier transform or any approximation. You can do it numerically exactly.
Oh, numerically, yes. Yeah, numerically you can solve it exactly. 2x2 problem you can solve exactly. That's not a problem. Good point you brought out. So these are exact results. These are not with any approximation regarding high frequency approximation or so on. Okay, so they are, some of them are numerically calculated, some of them are analytically calculated, but they are basically without any approximation regarding frequency. Yeah, okay. All right, thank you. Upper right. You mean here? No, I mean, first of all, in this part, it's a PT broken face, so you're just going to get PT broken at small enough. Yeah, now there are a number of wedges here, and indeed those wedges do go on, basically, but we don't have a characterization of them. This is one of the things which, if somebody has thoughts about how to do it analytically, and we should talk.
I know it.
Yeah.
This is exactly
sorry,
like
the answer
this.
Is no. Okay. There is a differential equation theorem to guarantee that edge is smooth.
No. Any other questions?
So if there is no other question, I have a question to the first part. If you have this single, it's easy to go to infinitely large lattice and move to differential operator in the square up with delta function, which is PT symmetric with plus gamma minus gamma.
Okay.
And it is also exactly solvable, and you may also analyze this phenomena, dependence on the distance.
Yeah, so we have done that actually in a finite well. So the limit you're talking about is where the number of lattice size goes to infinity and the lattice spacing goes to zero, such that the total length is finite, and therefore we don't have to worry about normalization at infinity. The boundary conditions are just that. In that case, at each of these center points, basically, or in between points, you do get, there's a scaling of n, how this gets suppressed, which is consistent with getting a positive threshold, which is one of your papers, early papers, where getting a positive threshold. I believe that the end points correspond to boundary conditions which are twisted, essentially, because then you have delta function appearing at end point, and that really gets implemented more like Robin boundary conditions, if I understand right. Basically, yeah, so it's all consistent with continuum results that you would obtain for a square one. Yeah.
Okay, if there are no other questions, so thanks the speaker again.
Thank you.